Hello, everybody, and welcome to another episode of Knerds of the Round Table, a weekly talk show where we react to and discuss the nerdy news. My name is Fred Sullivan, and after 3 weeks, this is my good friend, Jack Rooney.
Yeah.
It's been a long time.
I don't remember how to do this.
Yeah, no, I'm,
I usually say something, and I went just, yeah, and then I stopped.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, sorry for the prolonged absence. Vacation will do that to you. I was on vacation, and then there was also just like the time that we have in between. It makes it, I think, almost closer to 3 weeks or a month.
Yeah, by the time this goes up, it'll probably have been at least 3 weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, like I mean, you know, sorry, but stuff like this is going to come up. Hopefully not very often. And yeah, I mean, we'll try and do a better job of planning content in the intermediary time, but yes.
That was another thing. I wanted to apologize for not having the Dragon Ball Super video up. I promised it for the second week that I was gone. What happened was is that I was listening to myself when I recorded it, and I realized that I fucking hated it. I realized that it was terrible, and it was not me. And okay. I needed to re-record it. So I actually did that today.
Okay.
So I need to now just edit it and cut it and everything like that.
Okay,
so
cool.
It might take me a little bit, but I listened to it, and I was like, I sound like a fucking robot, and it does not have any of my personality in it. It has nothing, and I was like, I can't put that out.
Well, yeah, I mean, you know, peek behind the curtain. We discussed, like, what approach you wanted to take with it, and that is something I was concerned about, but there was only one way for you to find out what you wanted, you know? And
so, this one is, that's it. This is what I'm doing. I just now have to edit it and release it. Now, as long as that's going to take me, I don't know yet, given I do have a lot of TV shows to catch up on, because I have not watched anything since leaving, which is the beginning of Gotham, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. I haven't watched Flash, Arrow, Supergirl.
Oh, those are back.
All of them are back. Yeah. I haven't watched Westworld, which I wanted to catch up
I told you. Yeah. And like when I initially talked about Westworld, you were kind of like, oh, what's that about? Like it wasn't like a conversation that a lot of people were having. And in the 3 weeks since we last recorded,
it's getting exploded.
I know. Yeah, that's what I was like. Like I was like, oh, I'm curious about Westworld. And like didn't really get any response from anyone on it. Didn't, you know, like you or any of my other friends or anyone. Like nobody really knew. And I was like, it looks kind of cool. And then, like, overnight, just fucking...
it just blew up. I was like, holy shit, it's getting rave reviews. And I was like, all right, I have to look into it. So
I'm very excited.
I want to test out a few episodes. But there's also another show. The only show that I have watched is Luke Cage.
Okay, we are going to talk about that.
Yes.
Where do you want to start? Do you want to talk... Well, we're already here. How do you feel about Luke Cage?
Luke Cage, I think, is great in its own respect. Right? So... It is a show that, like, I actually, over the time at New York Comic Con, I was able to watch it with some filmmakers, my friends over at Ismahawk. I watched it with them on a 11-inch MacBook screen inside a room where we're all sprawled out.
Hey, that's the idea. That's how you want to watch beautiful cinematic things.
Not the ideal way to watch 5 episodes.
That's also how you want to hear the incredible sound design and the music that went into that
show. That's exactly what you want, right? And then the last 2 episodes, they were here. We watched it on the 4K TV with the 5-point runs.
Okay, that's
5-point surround sound.
That's better.
He was like, oh my God, it's clear. I was like, yeah. This is a big difference. Yeah. Anyway, I think the show is incredible. I think there's a lot we can really go into it. But basically what I'll say is I think that the tone of the show is fantastic. I think it's very fitting for the time right now with everything with Black Lives Matter and everything. As well as the music is just so well done in coordination with the show.
So I think, so in my opinion, it is a great show.
Yes.
I think it is... Personally, based solely on personal factors. So nothing about how it was made, nothing about like the quality of the production itself. But as far as characters and narration, like the things that you can really have an opinion on, you know?
Yes.
Not narration, but the narrative they're developing.
Yeah. I gotcha.
It is the weakest of the 3 Marvel Netflix shows. And like that is by a narrow margin. And I don't even think I could place Daredevil and Jessica Jones the rest in the order. I just know that I like this one the least, but very slightly.
So we discussed this briefly before.
Ahead of time, yeah.
And the thing is that each show kind of has its own tone.
Yeah, and it's got its own like theme and message that it seems to be trying to communicate.
Yes, exactly. Daredevil is much more of the action esque kind of show where it's, you know, justice, deliver justice.
Yeah, it's a show about what is justice. How are we okay with seeing, like, is it okay if justice comes from outside the law? And, like, you know, and I think that's why it, like, Daredevil, if you really think about it, had to come first. Because it answers the questions. It forces you to think about the questions that the other shows are going to deal with. You know what I mean? Like, because then you go into Jessica Jones and there's all this intrigue and mystery. But ultimately, she's trying to do things the right way and it's not really working out. So then things happen, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And then you get to Luke Cage and he's also struggling with the same thing about, like, I want to do this the right way, but I'm also a fucking superhero.
So. And I can't be killed. I'm just going to, you know, rip you apart.
Exactly.
Because I'm super strong.
So it's like you have to deal with the question of, like, what is justice? Are we okay with justice in this way before you go into, like, the deeper, I think the deeper stories of Jessica Jones and Luke Cage.
Yeah.
The more intricate stories.
Yeah. So we also discussed, like, as far as ranking them, I'm not going to discuss that. Yeah, you know, it's all based on preference and everything. Yeah. But I will say that I am thoroughly enjoying Luke Cage.
Absolutely.
It's fantastic. I am 7 episodes in. So I haven't watched the entire thing yet. So obviously a little early to be given, like, a full opinion on it, but from what I've watched, is incredible. And I am very eager to continue it, but there's just so many other things going on.
I think, yeah, I'm like 11 episodes in, so I'm not quite done with the season yet. I think the character development and plot, actually, they weaken a little bit in the later half of the season, which is maybe why I'm coming down on it just slightly harder. I still think it's great. I still think it's well worth watching. The one thing I don't really love about it is that, like, when characters are having a conversation, and this is probably persistent in all the Marvel shows and stuff like that, but, like, well, no, I mean, less so in Jessica Jones. Jessica Jones, it felt like characters were trying to have, like, real conversations about issues and, like, trying to figure stuff out, you know? Luke Cage, like, most of the characters communicate in one-liners. Like, most of the characters, like, say their snappy line and, like, walk out of a room.
I guess.
And it's, like, it doesn't always feel like they're real people trying to deal with a problem.
Well, the thing is, right, is that Jessica Jones is more of, like, a detective investigation type of thriller. It's not as much based on the action as Daredevil is, or Daredevil. Daredevil
however,
is.
However you want to.
Yeah, or, I mean, even Luke Cage has its action as well, but it is much more about, like, we talked about that as well, as far as, you know, how it compares to the other ones and how this one is very narrow in terms of it's just about one community and how the antagonists think that they're bettering the, like, that area, while Luke Cage is like, no, you're making it worse. And so,
yeah,
you know what I mean? But as far as the show itself goes, I don't want to go into it too deep because we have a lot to talk about.
And there's probably a lot of spoilers that we'd accidentally hit.
Not even. But show is great. If you are on the fence about watching it, I highly recommend it.
Oh, absolutely.
The thing is that Netflix and Marvel, they haven't shown that they've done anything wrong yet.
Yeah.
And that's in a complete honest opinion. We are 4 shows in now. What are you going to do?
Four seasons.
Yeah, 4 shows.
And so, there hasn't been a misstep yet, as far as I'm concerned.
No, no. So,
what have you been playing recently?
That's what I was going to say.
Because that's what we've been watching. What have you been playing?
So, with my vacation, I haven't really been able to play anything. The only thing that I've been able to do is I came back home on Monday. Today is Wednesday. I've played half of the campaign for Gears of War. I haven't touched the multiplayer yet.
How many hours would you say you've put in?
2 hours. Maybe 3.
And you played half the campaign?
Yeah. It's on normal. So, sure.
I mean, I'm not looking for it to be, like, this huge, long thing. I thought it would be longer. I'm not making a quality judgment. I just thought it would be longer.
Like I said, it's what I believe to be the halfway point.
Okay, sure.
I'm pretty sure it's Act 3, Chapter 3 that I'm in. So, like, pretty much the middle of the plot. The story is fine. It seems it was a little weird because as an avid Gears of War fan for, you know, since 2006, 2005, whatever it was.
Yeah.
2006. You've always fought one enemy. And, like, that enemy was your primary focus. The way this game starts out is actually, it was really cool for me. Because it is based off of the Aspho Fields book. Which I don't know if I want to get into spoilers or anything like that. But
you're a huge nerd.
I am a huge nerd. It's the book was awesome, and this one, it was just a touch on it, but, like, just seeing that, like, Just one thing was really cool.
Cool.
But yeah, so the story is all right. It just takes a little bit getting used to because this is years after the fact. This has got to be 20 to 30 years after.
Sure.
And everything has kind of changed. I mean, locusts aren't there anymore. But I'm learning some more stuff. I haven't completed the campaign, so I don't know everything. But okay. It's actually gotten a 9.2 from IGN. Like, it's getting good reviews.
Yeah, yeah.
And so far, I'm inclined to agree, given I haven't touched multiplayer yet and I haven't really touched Horde.
Sure.
But
I feel like if I owned an Xbox One, I would consider playing that game.
Yeah. I mean, quality product. My one gripe with the game, well, not even with the game itself, but with Xbox, mm-hmm. Microsoft, is the dead zone problems with their controllers. I don't know if you're aware of it.
No.
If you use a regular controller, there's like a what they call a dead zone, which is a space in between from when you're moving the joystick until it actually like
recognizes
reads.
It?
Yeah. PlayStation doesn't have it. They don't have any dead zone reads on any of their games because their controllers are pretty much automatic. The Xbox controller does, and I have purchased an Elite controller to bypass that. But the thing with the Elite controller is that you have to kind of... It's all customizable, so you have to like figure out what you want mm-hmm. and the way that everything is read.
I feel like that would bother me, actually.
It's a trial and error process.
Yeah.
And for me to try to get that is a little bit of a problem.
I would try and make a modification and then just be like, no, this is too hard. I fucked up the whole thing. And just, like, throw out the controller.
Yeah, because the thing is, right, is that, like, oh, well, you have, like, four different sets for your sticks. You can be smooth, instant, delay, whatever it might, or aggressive, or whatever it is. And then it's how extreme do you want that? Do you want -5? Do you want it +5? Do you want radial calculation? I'm like, I'm going to just try this and see if it works. And, like, it gives you two switches so you can adjust it and see which one you want. So it might be cool if like, oh, hey, I have this one for sniping, and then I have this one for shotgunning.
Sure.
Multiplayer. But I'm still trying to figure it all out, and that's where I'm like having some problems, because with the other Gears of War games, I also played Xbox strictly during that time, so I was a little bit more used to the controller. Anywho.
That would be just too much, I think, for me.
It's...
Like, I get it. Like, you know it better than I do, so you probably feel more comfortable with it, but I would just be like... lost in a sea of options there to the point that I would be paralyzed.
I don't use nearly as many options as they offer. Let's just say that. Anyway, what have you been playing?
Okay, so I borrowed Assassin's Creed Syndicate from Dave.
Mm-hmm.
And I lent him Deus Ex in return.
Okay.
Within like 2 days, this is a side thing, but like within 2 days, Dave texted me and was like, I fucking hate this game.
Yeah, I had a feeling.
And I was just like, it's a great game. Like, if you listen to our last, like, two episodes or whatever, you probably heard me talk about Deus Ex. It's excellent. And so, like, he texted me that, and I'm like, man, I'm not surprised, but shit, am I frustrated.
Yeah.
Like, it's just...
The thing is that Dave is a very particular taste in games, and, like,
and
I've tried to, you know, have him broaden, expand his horizons with
but
he's just very, very set on his ways.
So, whatever. But the thing is, like, he was, like... he desperately missed Assassin's Creed, and I was like finishing Assassin's Creed, and I was like, this game's like bleh. Like
great
Syndicate,
to
the
Dave.
Thing is like yeah right the it's great, it's amazing to him, and I guess it was an illustration of like the different tastes that we all have
exactly.
In a very like in your face kind of way for me, I guess, because like neither Dave nor I will mince words, like we'll just tell you, you know, and like my problems with Assassin's Creed is the fact that it feels like every other Assassin's Creed I've ever played.
Yeah.
And the thing is like if I went back and played, you know, Assassin's Creed 2, it would probably play very different from Syndicate, but it's like Syndicate is like moved in line exactly with what you would have expected from Assassin's Creed the whole time while making these slight adjustments to what is currently evolving in gameplay and control.
Mm.
Right? So it feels exactly how you would expect, even though I haven't played an Assassin's Creed in years. You know what I mean?
Makes sense.
And it's not a problem that it feels like what you would expect, because it's good that you know how to play the game. It feels natural to play the game.
So it's
but
good it all,
but like in terms of gameplay, you feel like you're doing the exact same things. Like you still run into very similar problems where you're like, no, I wanted to jump over there, but instead I ran up this wall.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're like, I was trying to jump onto this carriage that's passing by, but you can't. Like, you just can't, really, you know? Because like, instead I jumped to this flower box and now I'm on this and I totally missed my opportunity.
Yeah.
And in the game that tries to make itself about, like, setting up cool opportunities to do stuff, that can be really frustrating.
Absolutely. And that's always been the problem with Assassin's Creed games. And, you know, I told Dave, I was like, you know, I'll probably want to play that game at some point. And then it just never happened. Like, I thought it was going to happen this summer, and it just never did.
Yeah. I mean, like, I thought it was a good game, but nothing more. And I thought it was extremely representative of exactly why Ubisoft needed to take the break that they did.
Break, in quotations, because, what's coming out this year?
The remaster or whatever. But they're not, like, they're not even saying that the next Assassin's Creed is going to come out in 2017. I forget where I saw this story, but they're like, we're not really sure yet. Like, they're not, and that might just be them not wanting to announce anything ahead of time and give Kotaku a head start on the leak.
Yeah,
but at the end of the day, it's like, they're at least saying the right things to me, where they are taking a creative break. You know, remastering is cool, but I don't think I'm wrong in saying that, like, remastering something doesn't necessarily take creativity, because you are taking what was already creative and just polishing it up.
I agree with that.
It's not a simple thing, but I don't think it takes creativity.
Well, the other thing is, sometimes it's not even done by the same studio.
Exactly.
So I don't know about this one specifically, but it could be.
Well, Ubisoft has like thousands of studios. I'm sure they just gave it to one of them. Yeah.
Seriously.
Right. But the other thing I've been doing is playing XCOM 2.
Oh, yes, that's right.
And that is a game that I'm in love with. I'm so into it. It is so challenging. The game doesn't give a fuck about you. Like, it is so aggressively is completely uninterested in the fact that you're playing it. Like, it doesn't care so hard about you. Like, it is willing to put whatever in front of you that, like, it takes to, like, challenge you. And, like, if you were to walk away, the game wouldn't really feel bad about it. They're not trying to, like, coddle you or encourage you. They're not gonna offer you to drop it down to like a lower difficulty after you've had to retry a mission like 3 or 4 times.
And so, like, almost like Dark Souls or
kind of and like the thing is, like, you can totally fail every mission and you won't win the game. You'll lose, but that losing process will take like 10 hours.
Oh god.
Like, because you could just be like, you could just keep trying and keep trying and keep losing missions because, like, all your dudes died, and, like, you could, like, hobble along, and eventually you'll get to the point where you realize, I just can't. There's no way I can win, and that could take you a long time.
Oh, man.
And so the game isn't nice about it. You know, it's not like, hey, why don't you reload your last save? It's like,
oh, you're fucked.
It's like, and there's a mode specifically for that. It's called Iron Man mode, where you, I think it's called Iron Man, where after every single choice that you make, the game saves automatically, so you can never, and only one save. So you can never, ever go back.
Oh,
yeah.
Fuck.
So it's like, the game knows what it's about.
It's but, like, yeah, I hope you don't mind getting fucked back there. Good luck with it now.
I played it through on normal, and it was kicking my butt for a while, but I learned it, and I feel much more confident playing it now. And now I'm playing it on, I think, what's the hard difficulty, and I'm having a challenging time, but I'm having an easier time playing it in the beginning of the game on hard than I was playing it on normal initially, because I just understand the game better. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And what I love about it is the stories I feel like I have come from it. Like, I named my characters after people I know.
Yeah.
And, like, I tried to never lose anyone. And if I did lose someone, like, I was a baby about it, and I reloaded it, and I tried to find a way to save them. And, like, sometimes there's no way, but sometimes there is. And so I would try until I got there, right?
Mm-hmm. Did Dave die?
No, Dave made it all the way end. I made it all the way to the end, but I almost didn't. Like, on the last mission, I was like, my dude might die, and this is the last mission, so I just have to let it happen. Oh, like, God. I'm willing to sacrifice myself to the cause. And, like, you were in the last mission, and, like, you were having a tough time. Mm. Oh, wait, no, you didn't make it. You were you didn't die. You were in the penultimate mission, and you survived, but you were hurt, so you couldn't go on the last mission.
So, go for me, you sons of bitches.
So, you were, like, my support healer. Dave was my demolitions expert, basically.
Mm.
I was a sniper. And Kate, my fiance, was my psionics expert. So she was, like, a magic person, basically.
She's magical.
Yeah, she was a magic person. And it was very fun, like, playing the game, you know, trying to take care of these characters and, like, make sure they made it. And it felt very cool because, like, in the last mission, you know, my character is a sniper and, like, I set up this crazy circumstances using all of his skills in one round where, like, he had a suit with a grappling hook on it. So I had him grapple up to a higher ledge. Then which takes no movement or it costs your character nothing in terms of what they can do within a turn.
Okay.
I activated his chain ability. So, like, every time you kill someone with the chain ability, which is the last ability in the sniper line,
mm-hmm.
All your action points are refreshed. So if you keep killing people, you can keep playing. So he grapples up to this high ledge where he has no cover, but I'm like, no, this is it, because this has to be it. This was the only way I was going to succeed, right?
Mm-hmm.
I activate the chain ability, and then I activate his Deadeye ability, which costs an aim penalty, so he's less likely to hit someone. But if he does hit someone, he's going to do, like, 5 points more damage, which is huge.
Jeez.
So he just, like, he picks off the first guy, and... which also activates his another ability of his Death from Above, because he was up ahead, up like above these people,
mm-hmm.
where he can just keep using actions like over and over again.
Oh,
so I basically set up this like shooting gallery for my character. He kills like 4 or 5 aliens, and then shoots the last one with his pistol, which crits because of the angle that he's at, and kills that guy, even though there was like almost no way that was going to happen.
Oh, wow.
And then he gets mind controlled and like jumps down and tries to blow up this like this character that's super important,
mm-hmm.
with like, oh dude, it was unbelievable. And like the thing is, like, it shouldn't be that exciting. It's a turn-based strategy game. There's nothing that should be that exciting about it, because like everything you can see, you know, like it's not, you know, you're not running through a level in a first-person shooter just like blowing people away and doing cool things.
Yeah,
it's just
happens.
Like, yeah, it's just like, but what the game allows you to do, especially in terms of environment destructibility, can set up some really cool circumstances. I highly recommend everyone go play it, especially if you have a PS4, because then you don't have to like build the gaming rig that you would need to run it, because it's like a high cost game. Yeah. But it like chugs on the PS4. Like, it stutters at times. The load times, I'm not kidding, like 3 minutes.
Oh my god,
dude, like,
that sounds horrible.
Like, it's so bad. To the point that like there were times where I was like, man, I should really reload this, but I'm just gonna see how this plays out. Because, like, if I have to reload it, it's going to take, like, a few minutes. A few minutes.
Yeah, that's not good.
You know how, like, you sometimes load something, or you're, like, waiting for the game to load, so you, like, run to the bathroom, and by the time you get back, it's almost always done. And you're like, wow, I was really quick. How is it already done?
Yeah, yeah.
I could have gone and made a sandwich. One time, I was downstairs in my fiance's house. I went upstairs to the kitchen to get a glass of water, walked back downstairs, and, like, on the way was, like, playing with her dogs a little bit.
And it was still loading,
and I was like, oh, fuck.
Yeah. And that's how fun.
It gets worse and worse the later you go into the game. Because, like, and I talked about this on Twitter. You know, like, you're really invested. You really want to see it through to the end, especially if things are going well. And the game just, like, finds a way to punish you, even if you're not losing. every time you try and load something, go into a level, like, load a save, like... coming back from a level, like, everything takes minutes, and you're just like, oh, God.
Okay. All right, well, we've been talking about this for, like, 10 minutes.
Ah, sorry.
So, yeah, we need to get going. One thing I did want to talk about was just my vacation before we get into the stories.
Oh, right.
I was gone for about a week in California. I was staying with the man, the myth, the legend of Alfredo Diaz and his wonderful girlfriend, Jackie Butler. Fantastic time with them. We really didn't do like a ton of stuff, but it was just cool and just like very chill. It was a relaxation time, and
it's awesome,
much needed. And then 3 days there, we then went to stay with Sean for 3 days, or
cool.
2 nights. We were there within 3 days. We saw a Giants game at AT&T Park, the second to last game of the season. Unfortunately, they're eliminated from the playoffs right now, so I'm not happy about that, but.
Sorry.
That was something. We explored San Francisco for a while. Like, we went to a bunch of different districts, and I gotta tell you, I fucking love that city so goddamn much.
Yeah.
You
excited about Watch Dogs 2?
Yeah, I've always have been, but like, it's this one is like, just going there. We saw different districts than I saw previously. Like, we went up to Twin Peaks and a lot of cool sights that we saw.
Cool.
And I can't thank you enough. I don't know if you're watching this or not, Barrett, but you and Alyssa were fantastic. Thank you for everything. Sean was also there, helping out, everything, but I don't think he watches the show, so I don't know if I should thank him. But yeah, so if you are, thank you, Sean. I love you. So we did that, hung around there for a while, and then we headed back to Alfredo and Jackie's. We were there for like another 2 days.
Mm-hmm.
There was like great food had and a whole nine.
Awesome.
Just more relaxation time, more of. And then we came back. This is where it gets a little bit crazy, right? So
right.
We leave at noon on Tuesday. We then arrive, because we have to take transfers because we flew out of a different airport. So we arrive at Houston, and then we have to take a transfer. Our plane there, the fuel gauge doesn't work. So we had to wait for a new plane or for them to fix the issue. Luckily, it wasn't too long. It was like an hour or so. But we were already anticipating getting home at like or landing at midnight, our time, on Wednesday.
Okay.
I had to pick Tony Smith from Ismahawk up at 7 in the morning or 7:30 in the morning at JFK. So that hour delay got us back into like...
For context, JFK is like an hour, hour and a half
away. Oh, it took us an hour and a half to get there because of traffic.
Yeah.
But we land at like 12:30, go to Kelsey's dad's. We then pick up her car, drive back here, which is another half hour.
Jeez.
So 15 or 20 minutes to get to her dad's, half hour to get here. We sleep for like... 2 hours.
Yeah, I was trying to do the math. Yeah, that's pretty much
like
it.
2 hours. or maybe 2.5, 3 hours because we checked traffic and it wasn't that bad, and then it got bad. And so like we left right when it got bad.
Right.
And then we drove through Staten Island into JFK, picked up Tony at like 7:45-ish. We weren't there on time. Went to an IHOP, got food, drove back here, napped for a while. Thank you again, Tony. I don't think you watched this, but thank you for being cool with that. Because I was dying, and he was too. And we woke up, went to pick up the rest of the guys, Jeremy and Noel from Ismahawk as well, from Newark, which wasn't as bad, got sushi in Union, and then drove up to Harlem to drop them off at their Airbnb.
Okay.
And then drove back home.
Jeez.
Then to wake up the next morning to get me to a train station to go to New York Comic Con for the weekend. That was really the hectic part.
I'm getting tired and upset just thinking about this.
Yeah, yeah. It was like it was just very hectic. I can't thank them enough for being so cool with everything that went down. And then the weekend at New York Comic Con was just the most chill one that I've ever been a part of.
Okay.
Thursday, I was there with our boy Trozy and Brian. I don't know if you remember Brian.
I remember him. Yeah.
We stayed in an Airbnb with them, and we just kind of walked the floor.
Is Airbnb like the way to go?
It's cheaper,
yeah,
but riskier.
Okay.
Yeah, our place wasn't the best.
Okay.
like a shared bathroom and with like two floors, and it was not the best situation.
Okay.
It was like six bedrooms.
Sure.
So we went like walked the entire floor on Thursday. Awesome, cool with that. Mm-hmm. And then every other day it was just kind of like me hanging out with those guys.
Yeah.
Just doing what they do, and that was kind of it. And, like, got breakfast every day. There are some dope breakfast spots in Harlem. Home Sweet Harlem, whew, fantastic. The Grange,
whew, cool.
Fantastic. Then we had Cafe One, which is just kind of like a little cafe shop. But overall, the weekend was fantastic. I got to watch some Luke Cage with those guys. Additional two episodes here. It was an awesome weekend. I can't thank those guys enough for coming out. I'm wearing their shirt because as we're recording this is actually when they're going to be launching their Megatron, Megatron versus Voltron video. And we
Megazord.
Sure. Fuck me. Sorry.
You're lucky I remember that.
Yeah, yeah. Megazord versus Voltron. I don't know. It sounded weird.
Couldn't
coming out of my
what
mouth.
The difference was, but
Power Rangers. Voltron. Know. Anyway, that video is launching today. I am kind of just representing them. Supporting them. We cannot watch it before doing this video, so I don't know when we're going to be able to do like any type of reaction to the video, because I would love to do one for them. But we'll figure it out.
Yeah, sure.
And that was kind of it. Just kind of hung out, did that, relaxing the whole nine, and then I had to go back to work, and that sucked. But anyway, that's what happened on my vacation. We should probably get into the news, because that probably took me about 10 minutes. About 30 minutes in.
Okay, that's pretty much what I expected, actually.
Yeah, yeah. So that's actually what we anticipated.
Yeah.
But
Also, I think that might be messed up. So, let's get into it.
Yes, it is.
I know.
Yeah. Sorry for the audio again. I gotta send this out. I'll just deal with this.
Yeah. So, what we wanted to start with was kind of a callback to an issue that we had spoken of multiple times, the No Man's Sky false advertising thing.
Yeah.
I'm sure if you are keeping up with gaming news, like, you've heard this story a million times, so we're probably not going to talk about it for too long, but... No Man's Sky, like, there's an official advertising standards investigation launched into it. And I'm pretty sure it's just a European thing. If they are found fraudulent, I guess, then they can pull advertisements down for the game, as far as I know.
Okay.
Like, that's, I mean, which is, like, it's more a statement than anything else, I think.
Yeah, and
And it's something that people have been clamoring for because of, you know, all the drama surrounding what was promised and what ended up in the final version of the game.
Yes.
I'm not really here to tell you one way or the other which side I think is right. It seems like there were some things that... There's definitely... Yeah, I'm not even going to mince words. It seems like Hello Games?
Yes.
Is that... Yeah. I feel like they could have done a much better job communicating. They could have done a much better job communicating post-release. And I feel like this is entirely... almost entirely on them. Because if they wanted to... If they wanted to get out ahead of something, then they should have done it a long time ago.
Yeah. This could have been completely avoided.
Sure.
The thing is that we spoke about this previously, and we didn't want to take part in it, really, like, choose a side.
Yeah.
But it's getting to the point now where I don't believe Hello Games has said much of anything since the release of the game.
It's become clear that, like... So, I did read... It's not on our list, but, like, I did read a story where Sean Murray of Hello Games is, quote, like, willing to talk about what went wrong on, unquote, on, who does the video game awards?
The
public face of it.
I don't remember.
Also, I think he organizes it.
So oh, you're talking about Jeff Keighley?
Jeff Keighley, yeah. Jeff Keighley has, like, a new talk show.
They're talking about the company.
No. He has a games show or something. Mm-hmm. So, Sean Murray says he would be willing to discuss it on his appearance there, I guess. So, I don't know. We'll see if anything comes of that. But this is clear that... I guess what I'm more interested in here will there be far-reaching consequences? Do you think we'll see gaming advertisers and gaming developers and publishers kind of reel it in a little bit? Or do you think this is a one in a million, like, nobody cares, everyone's going to keep going about it except for this group of people?
Probably not. I don't think it's going to change much, to be completely honest with you.
I think you're probably right, but I think it should.
The thing is I think that people will look at this as a lesson to be learned as far as, well, maybe we should communicate a little bit more.
Yeah.
Because, like we said, Sean Murray, before the release of this game, was extremely active on his Twitter.
Saying a lot.
He was communicating, letting people know how excited he was, the whole nine.
Certainly more active than I am.
Exactly. And, sorry, didn't mean it like that, but
that's fine.
I was just trying to continue my
point.
I made
the joke, it's fine.
But he was super active, and then as soon as the game released, and he, I guess maybe he heard some things, he was kind of like, I want to back away a bit. That's where you're running into the problems, because you're not really resolving anything PR-wise, and fans are going to be upset enough that they'll look at loopholes in the system to try to figure out some way to make you, quote-unquote, pay for this, I guess, would be...
So, I mean, like, whether it's, like, demanding Steam returns, whether it's demanding investigations into your practices, in lieu of a conversation or an apology from the developer...
Yeah.
They're going to look for external resolutions to this problem.
Exactly.
And what they see as a problem. And what is probably a problem.
Yeah, the thing is that this, again, could have been completely avoided by them just saying, like, all right, well, we're looking into the issue. We're going to probably try to bring it out, whatever it might be.
Yeah.
Issue some type of apology to the fans.
Yeah.
The people that purchased this game that were extremely excited for this game for years.
Too excited, but still within the bounds of reasonability, but, I think.
You know, those people are the ones that supported your game and shared all the details about it. And you don't even really give them an opportunity or, not an opportunity, but as much of like a reasoning as to why this stuff didn't happen.
Yeah.
And, you know, like I said, we said this before, and it's like, yeah, it's, you know, it's wrong, but in the same way, you can't believe in the hype all the way that they might have.
And you usually want to wait for a review on games. And this is like, you know, I do feel a personal connection to this because I was an evangelist of this game.
Yeah.
This is one of those games that you could say something to someone who wasn't particularly interested in games and get them excited about it because... Yeah. I mean, like, I remember a conversation I had with a coworker, like, 2 years ago or something like that, where I was like, hey, I heard about this game that's being developed. They're developing a literally almost infinite universe.
Mm-hmm.
It's the biggest thing that's ever been, like, conceived in games. You know what I mean? And I talked about, like, the fact that you were going to be traveling from planet to planet, like, no load times, like, all these different, you know, features that did end up in the game. But there were things about it. I don't think the most special things about it for me personally, but there were things about it that didn't make it in, certainly.
Yeah.
So I do feel like a small sense of betrayal, but I mean, we've had that conversation before,
yeah.
I guess.
It's, I just kind of wanted to give my opinion about as to like, really if this lawsuit is deserving or whatnot, maybe deserving is the wrong
investigation,
word.
Investigation.
Yeah. It's, the situation is that you should just be open and honest with your fans from the get-go, regardless of what the situation is. Let them know that you're investigating it, or you're going to be trying to release an update at some point within the near future, or whatever it might be.
Yeah, whatever the case is.
These are the people that are supporting your game, supporting your dream. Just give them a voice, just saying, like, hey, we're sorry it didn't make it in. But that's kind of it. That's all I really wanted to say.
Yeah,
but,
no, absolutely.
And I will get into your crappy topic.
Yeah, it's not, I mean, it's not even so much coming. I'm just, I'm like, so I was rolling through, through Reddit games, and I saw words that never fail to catch my eye.
Mm,
and yes. the word is Terraria.
Yeah. Well, it's not words. It's just words.
It's just the one word. No, I should have said one of the words.
Yeah, yeah.
That catches my eye. Right now, the words that catch my eye are Stardew Valley, Terraria, and Indy.
Indy.
Yeah. Which comes up a lot, so I get tricked a lot.
Yes, you do.
But anyway, this is news about a mod that's being released, and I don't know if it's... I mean, most mods are free, so I don't think it's like a paid...
Sometimes they're...
There was a conversation... I think it depends on where you're getting it from. I think if you're getting it through Steam, they don't allow monetization anymore. I think that was a thing for a little while, if I remember the news correctly, then they rolled it back.
Anyway.
But anyway, it's Super Terraria World. And what it does for Terraria is it makes the game, it makes it even better than it already is by adding, and this is not a mod from the developers, it adds new, I guess that would be just an update, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
That's what mods are called when developers do it.
Yeah, it's just an update.
Anyway, so what this mod does is it adds like new quests, NPCs, like new dialogue options, new items, new ways of creating land, like the world, like, so instead of just having this flat surface of a world that you have in Terraria, they layer it so you can walk in a door that's placed kind of in the background and end up in an entirely new environment, or jump on like a small raft somewhere and it, you know, you go through a loading screen and you're in a completely different place than you were before.
Yeah.
Which, like, Terraria, as incredible as it is, like, this mod is doing things that I didn't even realize I wanted from the game, but seeing them in there, it is so exciting. So, like, I just found out about this. I can't wait to finish this podcast and go play that.
Oh, God.
I gotta see it, you know? So, well, I just wanted to share that. If any of you have listened to me at all and are interested in Terraria, this is what you, like, you have to be excited about this.
Yeah, I mean, it's really cool just to see,
like, I made you watch the trailer.
Yeah, you did. not the entire thing, luckily, but...
Sure.
You know... It looks interesting, and it's just cool, as we said before, that people are continuing to give games love even years after release.
Yeah.
So.
And I'm glad it's Terraria.
You would be.
This next story is also a touchback on something that we've done before, where Sony kind of reversed their position on mods for Skyrim and Fallout 4. And 4K apparently is coming to those releases as well. But Sony is agreeing to let people mod those games on their console as promised.
Okay.
Provided that the mods use, I think, exclusively in-game assets, which is how you're going to avoid things like genitalia.
Yeah.
Like,
I mean,
questionable content, like things that could upset a parent watching their kid who just like went into the mod menu of whatever these games are.
Giant like, boobies.
Yeah, like
click.
Exactly. Like the kind of dumb crap you would do if you were a kid.
Yeah.
I mean, just
game
like,
let me put giant boobs on everybody.
You'd be like, yeah, sure. Yeah,
fuck
put
yeah. that in there. Free? Cool.
So Sony is trying to avoid, I guess, any liability in this arena, which is probably a smart move. It's just something that it's you know, it relates back to the No Man's Sky thing where it's like, well, if this was communicated ahead of time, like, hey mods, like you're gonna have them, but we don't want you going too... You can't go too crazy with it, you know? Or, like...
Which is good and bad.
Yeah, I understand it. I do think it is a smart move. And I think reversing their position and allowing these mods in this way is the best option.
It's a good idea.
You kind of assuage these fans who are all upset, and you avoid the exact circumstances the exact original reasoning that you weren't going to do it in the first place.
It's a good idea, but I think that it also takes away from a little bit of the mods, because, you know, some of the best mods that you could think of are stuff like, well, this game has nothing to do with Star Wars, but here's lightsabers.
Yeah.
Or like, oh, now you have Force Lightning, or like, it just stupid shit like that, you know? And that not being allowed in there because it's not part of the original code or whatever items were in the game.
Yeah.
It could, you know, take away from it in that regard. And as far as, you know, not allowing X-rated content or anything, that, of course, is always good for parents. Yeah. But, I mean, these games are rated M for mature.
Yeah.
One would assume that if you do that, you understand what is in the game. Now, as far as mods go, it's not something that does have a parental control kind of setting on there or anything like that. Yeah. So I get it, but at the same time, like, it's a tough thing to balance. But I do appreciate Sony at least allowing them in some way
to bring mods. Something, right?
Yeah, they're trying to, you know, not be
dicks.
Dicks. I was going to say something much worse. But also not
have dicks.
Yes,
on
but
the screen.
Dicks and balls.
Yeah. So
it's good or bad.
It's like good. It's good. I mean, anytime you're going to try and restrict anyone over anything, it's like going to upset some people. But what are you going to do?
Yeah. All right. So obviously with New York Comic Con being this past week, we should probably talk about some of the trailers and everything that we're talked about. So we'll go with the first one, which the one I remember very vividly is Iron Fist.
Right. Yeah. So the fourth Defender or whatever, yeah. I guess. That he's going to be the last one to have his own individual show before they join them all together or something, right?
Yes.
Something along those lines.
I don't know when Punisher comes out, but that's...
Is he part of that?
I don't think he's part of the Defenders themselves, but he is going to have his own show. Well, I don't know exactly. I'd have to look into it. But yeah, we watched the trailer shortly before this, and
it looks cool. I have much less, like, I don't, like... So I was open to the idea of Daredevil because I watched the Ben Affleck Daredevil, like, all those years ago, shame on me, right? Yeah. Shame on me. But the thing is, like, I liked the concept of his character a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
And Jessica Jones I was open to because I enjoyed, like, the Netflix Daredevil so much, you know?
Netflix Marvel stuff, yeah.
But, like, now I'm used to that, and I have no love or any context for Iron Fist.
Mm-hmm.
So it probably has the most...
To prove?
It probably has the greatest chance of letting me down. Trying to be careful about how I word it because, like, odds are it'll be the fourth awesome property from Netflix or from Marvel on Netflix, right?
The thing is, I said it before, is that Marvel and Netflix have not done anything wrong yet.
Exactly.
The thing is, right, is that this show, I think, is going to be more along the lines of Daredevil, where it is action sequences. Like, this guy is a martial artist.
Yeah.
And he has a super powerful fist that makes people blow up.
Just the one, though?
Well, I think it's that one fist, but he does have extreme power everywhere. Now,
okay.
To be honest with you, I don't know a ton about Iron Fist.
Exactly, neither do I.
I also don't know a ton about all these characters that were released in the Marvel. I know
that his fist was glowing, and then he, like, punched through a wall and maybe people. I don't know.
So from what my friend was telling me about this, Trozy, he was like, in the comics, he punched through a dragon's heart and had the power of the dragon imbued into his hand.
Okay.
And so that's why
sounds like a really lame.
But okay. I mean, yeah. Okay. But so the thing that it's looking like, though, is that the tone of this show looks like he is going to be an outcast. Because from what my understanding is about Iron Fist is that he is essentially an extremely wealthy man, owns a company, but he was taken away at a young age, and everyone thought he was dead.
Mm-hmm.
He then comes back to take back the company, but in that time that he was gone, he trained martial arts and apparently had this fist of power.
A little bit like a Batman situation.
Almost, right? But if you look at it, he was taken from his family.
Yeah, he didn't choose to train.
Exactly. Yeah. So he's an outcast amongst the people that he was brought into because it's martial arts, which is, you know, majority Asian
kind of culture. Especially where he was training, certainly.
Yeah, absolutely. Like it looked like in the Himalayas. Something so, like that. Yeah, in mountains. Somewhere.
It's always in mountains.
Yeah, right? Exactly. But then comes back not being part of the society for however many years and is again an outcast amongst what some may refer as his own people.
Yeah, normal society, sure.
Yeah. So he's trying to mesh everything together while also having these extreme martial arts abilities and I guess wanted to do something for the city. We'll find out.
So, the part that I'm maybe most concerned about is like, you know, Daredevil, I was interested because it's a story of like someone rising from really tough circumstances, mm-hmm. From nothing to something and trying to make his neighborhood a better place, despite the fact that he doesn't have he doesn't have a lot of like really cool powers.
No.
Like he doesn't.
You're gonna see.
Doesn't have a ton going for him, you know.
He's blind, but he can see.
Yeah, and like we discussed earlier, there are themes of like what is justice? Is justice what, you know, what good people can do to stop bad people, and who makes that call? Mm-hmm. You know, and then you know Jessica Jones. It's like this really dark story about, yeah. I mean, about like rape and like sexuality and like choice and consequences that arise from like an imperfect system, right? Yeah,
essentially like mind control and shit too. Yeah, exactly. Like it can get real deep.
Yeah, it's a really dark, really, you know, scary story. And, yeah. And thematically it deals with a lot of these things, right? And then Luke Cage, you see this story about like a kind of oppressed culture, like people who are held down by the nature of the system and like, you know, their efforts to kind of rise above, but there are also people who try to take advantage of it. And it's like, you know, it's a really complicated story about like a community and about the society that community exists within and how that kind of interplays. Right.
Yeah.
What is the theme? Like, what will Iron Fist be dealing with? Like,
I don't know enough about Iron Fist to say anything, yeah. But as far as what the trailer showed it has piqued my interest. I am interested to see how it goes. The combat, the short thing of combat you see, seems to be intriguing. And if it's going to be the same people that did Daredevil, it's probably still going to be pretty good.
It's probably going to be really good.
Yeah. So I am willing to give it a shot. I'll say that.
Absolutely.
But yeah, so I'm excited for that. That comes out March of 2017.
So, a long way, I guess.
Yeah, not really. It's 5 months.
Okay.
I mean, if you really think about it, yeah, like Daredevil was like 2 years.
Yeah.
I think it's something like that. Yeah. But yeah, so there was that. Another trailer that was released was Power Rangers.
Right.
What was your feeling on that?
It looked cool overall.
Yes.
But there was a high level of like kind of that campiness, the kind of like, I wasn't really in love with Power Rangers. Like I didn't really watch the show that much. Oh, yeah, I know.
Shame.
Yeah, exactly. Ring the bell. but I didn't love Power Rangers already. So this trailer is not going to, like, with all of its appeals to people who did love Power Rangers, is not going to really impress me for that. But if you look at kind of what the story they seem to be trying to tell, it could be good. It could be bad. It's hard to guess from this teaser.
Yeah.
But you can say that. And then also love it for its Power Ranger-iness.
Yeah, I mean,
so I feel like I'm coming at it from the wrong place.
The thing is that Power Rangers itself was a show that was just kind of ridiculous, yeah. If you really think about it, you know. It was essentially teenagers that gained the ability to become they were martial arts experts out of nowhere. And then just started beating up these guppy monsters. And
yeah, which, how does that translate?
Fucking no idea, but that's why I'm interested. Okay, fair enough. But I get a large Chronicle feeling from this, as I was telling you. It's like, the way that the trailers start, or like, it ends up getting to, is that they find like this like stone, and then they blow it up, and then they're like, oh, well, this weird thing inside, let's touch this, and then, yeah, shit happens.
Yeah.
Why would you want to touch that thing inside the stone? Who knows, but as far as like the themes and everything that it kind of aims for, with like Jason having fight with his parents, and like it seems that there's a lot of like problems that they didn't have. Yeah, they didn't really have with the original show. Yeah. And I think that this understands what it is, and it's essentially for a little bit older generation now, where, you know, you still want that Power Ranger stuff, but you still want maybe a little bit more maturity to it. And I think that's what it's trying to aim for.
Maybe. I mean, like, to me, I don't know if, and I'm coming at it from, like, a different perspective than most people who would be excited about it again, but, like, I don't know if people know, or maybe not know, I don't know if people know, like, realize what they're asking for when they're asking for Power Rangers back. Because if you watch...
Oh, no, they do.
Okay, because if you watch Power Rangers, like, I've seen a few episodes, like, in the past couple of years, like, as more of an adultish person.
Yeah.
It's a little silly.
Yeah,
it's like it a is. Little silly.
Do you understand how hardcore the Power Rangers
fan base is? I guess what I'm saying, though, is like if you're trying to make it relevant and new again, I think you're going to either upset some people who are into it for those reasons, for the silliness, the camp, the whole, you know, that stuff, or you're going to upset people who are trying to get into it for not really being serious and not really being like a modern movie, a modern production. Like, you know, I don't know how they're going to pull off that
balance. It's all about balance. Exactly. Right. So it's all about balance. But I think that they're going for a mature look of it, but it will still have some of its campiness. Absolutely. Yeah. And I think that's why I'm excited for it, because it's taking a little bit different spin than it ever has before. And I'm interested to see how they incorporate all of that into a storyline that would be good for an adult.
Yeah.
You know, so
I think it risks falling into the Transformers trap, where it's either like way too serious and like there's very little there that is reminiscent of what it used to be, or you go the other route and it's like all camp, all for the people who used to love it, not really much there for audiences who are looking for a new thing.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, I got you.
And you will see how that balance plays. You're right.
Yeah. So we'll have to see. But that also brings back to the video with Ismahawk. Be sure to check that out.
Okay.
Add their channel.
Fair enough.
Anyway, because that whole thing. What was it? Was that it for the news?
I don't know. Was there anything else we wanted? As far as trailers? Yeah.
John Wick.
John Wick, yeah. I mean, they had their second trailer, I think. Or no, maybe that was the first trailer. But yeah, last time we talked about the poster, because I was excited that it was happening.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that trailer looks dope. As a John Wick fan, based solely on the, you know, like as a, I watched the first movie and I really liked it. It had everything I wanted it to have, where like he's playing this very serious character, which I think is inherently a little comical with Keanu Reeves, just because he like does it well, but he also doesn't, like, he's very dramatic about his badassery.
Okay.
And I think it kind of makes me smile. But not because I think he's, like, so cool, but because I think it's like watching someone try and be really cool and kind of getting there. I don't know. It's weird. Okay. It's a weird thing. But, yeah. I mean, as far as the action, like, he's shooting a whole bunch of dudes. That looks really cool. He's fighting a whole bunch of dudes. That looks really cool. Morpheus shows up, making this whole thing feel a lot like The Matrix. So, I'm very excited to see where it goes.
Yeah. I haven't watched John Wick. The first one.
Yeah.
We're going to
fix that. We are going to fix that.
I heard good things about it, so I have to do it. But, this trailer has made me I should probably watch the first one because this looks pretty cool.
Yeah.
So
I feel like whenever someone brings you, in particular, a new piece of media, you're just like, fucking add it to the pile.
Yeah, well, that's my problem right
just,
now.
Just put it on the pile.
Like, my day off today, I probably just should have watched TV, but I didn't. I also have a ton of podcasts to catch up on.
I feel like I've climbed my podcast mountain. I'm almost all caught up on back episodes of the new things I'm into. I think I'm all caught up on the new stuff of like podcasts I've been trying to keep up with. I feel good about my podcast place right now.
I've been trying to listen to Pockets Full of Soup. Yeah. I haven't listened to much of anything yet.
We'll see what happens to my podcast listening when my journey to work is cut by like a factor of two.
Yep, that'll certainly affect it.
We'll see what happens.
All right. Let's get into the viewer questions now that we are about 54 minutes in.
We got to crush these.
Yes. Well, we'll see.
I mean, we got to crush these.
Yeah. Well, it's at 8:09 right now.
Okay.
So we got some time.
Oh, all right. Oh, yeah. I always forget that okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Let's go with the first one. So our boy, Andrew Minimas, thank you for submitting this forever ago.
He submitted this question
on September 28th. Yeah, hella early. A question for me, asking if what I feel.
How do you feel about Destiny 2 coming to PC and about how the game, I think, being dramatically different from what it was originally?
The thing is, right, is that Destiny 2, in any way, shape, or form, is probably going to be an improvement. Going to PC, a lot of people think that it might be bad. I am of the opposite camp, where I think that it is actually going to enhance it, because that will bring more of the MMO kind of vibe to it, in which it might only help it, because then you have people that understand what you have to do to kind of make that an actual massively multiplayer online game, rather than just like, well, here's
this
three
half measure. Yeah.
It wasn't even half. It was like, here's three people in a fire team, playing online, you could do six people on each side, and like as far as meeting people in the world, it's very, hey, how's it going? Oh, you're gone. All right, peace, whatever. So I think that it can only improve it, and in all honesty, I think that all the information that they've gathered from the past, two and a half years now for Destiny, they have to make this next game distinguishably better.
Yeah, I mean, like, so the thing that gives me hope for Destiny 2 is that my problems with Destiny 1 aren't mechanical. Like, yeah, no. That is a game with a very solid base. And when I think about a game like that, I think about Borderlands 1.
Mm-hmm.
And about how Borderlands 2 took everything that was mechanically cool about Borderlands 1 and gave it better characters and gave it better story and gave it better, you know, all this stuff. So I think mechanically, they nailed it in the first try, yeah. Right? But the problems that surrounded it were based on the narrative, were based on online interaction, what you could do, the scope of what they were going for versus what, like, fans kind of wanted. Like, I wanted something much bigger than what they provided, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, and that was the thing, is that game did not meet the expectations, much like, well, should we bring it back to,
No Man's Sky?
No Man's Sky.
I mean, like, it's, so...
But they addressed their problems, yeah. And they released updates to fix said problems.
Partially fix, I would argue, well, but, yeah. But this is their opportunity to refresh the whole thing. And exactly. I think, honestly, I mean, I'm excited for the idea of Destiny 2, despite mm-hmm. the fact that I'm not really interested in Destiny 1, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, I mean... I know it's a question for Fred, but you know, there's my answer.
Yeah. So basically, I'm excited for Destiny 2. I think that it being ported to PC will only help the game.
Yeah.
That's in short.
Sure.
Short form.
Andrew Minimoss hits yeah. it for the next next tweet, which is a two-parter.
Two-parter.
In classic Ooh, Andrew Minimoss right. form, he hit it. He hit the ground hard. He hit it running. I don't know. Yeah, whatever.
He's chugging. He's a chugging
as usual. One, do you think the recent and much-needed surge in great black characters in games and movies will make an impact on the COD versus Battlefield 1 battle as Battlefield 1 has a black protagonist compared to Call of Duty having a white one? Ideally, for me, I mean, like, I'm probably not going to play either one of these games.
No.
But in terms of which narrative excites me more, it doesn't really have a ton to do with, like, the protagonists themselves, but more the circumstances that like the events are happening in. I think, much like Mafia 3, I think this does present an interesting, like, narrative option for, you know, how people treat your character and, like, giving you maybe a window into a life that is different than yours. And I think that is exciting. And I think you nailed it in your own question. Like, I think this is, it's great that there are these new characters that are good characters
mm-hmm.
that give us those opportunities to experience something that we never will or never could. And I think that that's what video games are really all about.
Yeah.
That's what video games are supposed to be. You live
in another person's shoes for however long you're playing the game.
Yeah. And, like, some people are uncomfortable with the idea of that character not reflecting something close to their own life already. But to me, like, it's just a greater opportunity to see something you've never seen before.
It's like when you're reading a book and that the main character of the book is whatever ethnicity you want them to
be. Yeah, or even in some, you know, some books where there's like a primary female protagonist, I'm like, oh, this is something I haven't seen before.
Yeah, even movies or TV shows, instance, like Jessica Jones, as much as we've spoken about that
Luke Cage this episode.
Yeah. I mean, like, it's only going to help the situation with everything going on, and I think that it is a great idea to put it into video games, because that's another media that people consume extremely heavily and will kind of get them a grasp on the situation that's occurring. So I'm down with it. As far as which one I'm going to play, I'm probably playing Call of Duty, but I'm not really playing Call of Duty. I'm playing Call of Duty 4.
Sure.
But yeah, it's the story I am more interested in is Battlefield 1, as you said as well, much more around this actual overall
setting and theme and
everything, rather than it just being the character.
Yeah, that's part of it, I guess.
Yeah, but you obviously play through the game to figure out what the character is and everything.
I mean,
and
in both games, you're going to be shooting a lot and probably blowing a lot of things up. I don't know if character development is going to be a central point in either one of them. So, I mean, it's, I don't want to say that it's an invalid point, but it's probably, I mean, I'm worried about it being a missed opportunity more than I am excited about it being something I haven't seen.
Two huge games, but we don't know how they're going to execute that. But we'll see.
Sure.
Next question comes from our boy. Oh, I'm sorry. From the love of my life. Not Kelsey Lynn. Tom Hawkins. Lovely to have you on the show, Tom. He says, I miss you guys. What would it take to get you guys to come to England? The flight is expensive.
Yeah.
Living there is expensive. Like, however long you're going to stay there for. And food is okay from what I hear. I don't know. I mean, I would love to visit.
I'm a firm believer in that there is some good food everywhere. I feel like that is a tough, like, stereotype. Ireland? Yeah, no, I feel there's good food in Ireland. I feel like that is a tough stereotype that, like...
Sorry, Amy.
The British Isles or whatever have to, like, deal with. And then it's kind of shitty because, like, there are good restaurants anywhere. Yeah. But, like...
No, I'm fucking with you. I know. I would love to go to England. The problem is right now is money. And to basically...
Isn't the problem always money? Like, always money. And, like, I'm in the same boat. Like, the only thing that is keeping us from you, Tom, like, I don't care about the flight. I don't care about, like, what I would eat. It's just money. So,
yeah,
like...
the money is the problem. I mean, and obviously, if you would let us stay with you, that would be one thing as well.
Oh, that'd be great.
But, yeah, no, I would love to go. It's just... I'm pretty sure the tickets for that are expensive to go to London, aren't they?
We'll have to look it up after we record.
Yeah, I'll look it up. I thought they were like over 400. I could be wrong. I don't know.
Like each way? I don't know. Maybe.
I honestly haven't looked into it, but if you want us to come out there, Tom, I'll look into it for you.
Yeah. Let's
move on. Yeah. All right. From our boy, Josh Manansala, he asks, Gears of War 4 impressions. I kind of gave them earlier. I don't have a ton to say yet. I haven't played multiplayer. But... the campaign is okay. Like I said, it's a bit weird. I don't want to really get into spoilers yet, considering the game has only been out for not even a week yet. But it's weird to get into the story a little bit in the beginning, at least. But as far as the storytelling goes and everything like that, better than the first one. So that's certainly something. And I'm only about halfway through the game right now. So we'll see what happens.
Cool. Our friend Dave sent us a GIF. Of Zoolander's but why male models thing. I'm not sure if
because I used the one.
Oh, you used Zoolander in your
my original tweet out.
Okay. All right.
Yeah, I thought that was good. Did you see that, by the way?
It's right here.
We're back.
Yeah,
and then they just jump. I was like, perfect. It's been like a month.
All right, that was very confusing. I was like, this isn't a question.
Yeah,
at all.
No, that was in response to that.
So
it's Bubalo.
Next to Bubalo the Destroyer, and we are saying that correctly. I think I finally nailed some of these pronunciations.
Yes.
Thoughts on Overwatch skins? What do you want to see? Also, how many pumpkin spice lattes have you had so far?
Fuck pumpkin spice lattes.
I actually fuck them. Agree with that. Well, what's wrong? What is your problem with pumpkin?
Because
No. What is your fucking problem with pumpkin?
I'll tell you what my goddamn problem is, Rooney.
Sure, like okay.
They take over everything.
Okay, go ahead.
Pumpkins take over the entire fucking month, they just don't let up. And you know who else fucking loves pumpkin spice lattes? Kelsey. And I have to deal with it for the entire month.
Okay. Here's my problem with pumpkin spice lattes.
Yeah, because you work at Starbucks.
I make like 50,000 of them every fucking day. So I think I'm winning. Yeah, also, in terms of pumpkin like takeover during this month, I'm actually pretty cool with it because I love pumpkin pie. I love
pumpkin pie.
Yeah, pumpkin pie. But like, what else do you have to do? I like pumpkin bread, but we sell that year-round at Starbucks. Bread. So like, you can get that whenever you want. Pumpkin spice lattes are the only thing that negatively affects my life that is pumpkin related in the month of October and November.
By the way, when I was in San Francisco, I went to a Starbucks and they had a caramel apple
pound cake.
Yeah,
the best loaf that we have.
Oh,
and by the way, it's gone. Like
what?
Like we could. I've been trying to. This is not for you anymore, audience. This is for me and Fred. At least at our store, we can no longer order them, which usually means it's like a significant outage. Everywhere, so that might be
fuck you, Starbucks. Yeah, I'm looking at you.
The thing is, like, I don't think they anticipated like the support that they were gonna find there. But that is, when we had that, people would be like, "Oh, caramel." I was like, "That is the best thing that we have in this store." If you do not walk out with one of those items, you are giving up on the best thing. Now it's also like 600 calories. But don't ignore that, because so are like that. All of our drinks, so whatever.
Oh, buddy. but God, that was fantastic. I had those, and I was like,
that like cream cheesy icing on top. I'm getting hungry just thinking about it. Man.
Sorry, you didn't have to see my tongue movement there. But that happened. But anyway, Overwatch skins. I don't know if you watched the trailer for it at all.
No, I don't really care about Overwatch.
Okay, it's essentially there is a new expansion coming out that they officially like, hey, it's coming out because it wasn't before. there's going to be almost like a horde mode kind of thing with your characters, in which you fight like creations of Dr. Junkenstein or whatever the fuck it is. It's Junkrat as like Dr. Frankenstein.
Okay.
So all the skins are Halloween related. And there's a bunch of sprays and a whole bunch of stuff like that. Yeah. they're fine. You know, my thing is that, and Kelsey hates me for this as well, is like Halloween isn't a huge deal for me. Like I don't love Halloween.
Yeah.
But you know, some skins are cool,
mm-hmm.
but it's not like I'm going to go running back to that game.
You're not like, oh, Halloween stuff.
That's yeah. Good. I mean, like I have Gears of War right now. Go fuck yourself, Overwatch. Sorry.
So Dave Ardito asks next, the same Dave that sent us the gift.
Yeah.
Will VR be a bust after reports are showing a steep decline in usage just before the release of PSVR? Personally, I think that PSVR has the best shot at being the winner in this VR race. So, I mean, VR could be a bust, absolutely, but I think that PlayStation has the best chance of making it work. So, I guess what I'm saying is, like, we haven't seen the peak yet.
Yeah.
As far as I'm concerned.
So the thing is that it's not officially released yet.
Yeah. You know?
So as far as the people that have received the devices are pretty much the people that have tested them out previously anyway. So they already have their opinions.
Mostly gaming media anyway.
Yeah. But the thing is that this item is getting fantastic reviews.
Yeah.
It's not like everywhere. It's not like, oh, well, this is bad.
Yeah.
You might have some people that obviously get motion sickness or whatever it might be from it.
That was always the barrier to entry anyway.
Yeah, that's you will get used to that is the thing. You know, it's a completely different level of gaming now, like almost like the thumbstick from when we put that in from directional pads. Like completely different feel. And this is obviously a much bigger jump in that. But I think that the sales are going to be what we expect them to be. It's going to be people that are willing to invest the money into it.
Into a Gen 1 version.
Yeah, you know. From not many games being released. Like, it's more of experiences. You know, we know the people that are going to get those and know what they're going to expect. I think that once we get some more games out there that are like, oh, this is for PlayStation VR, that's when I think we'll get a little bit more tread on the tires there.
Yeah, we'll see. I mean, like, again, I think PlayStation VR has the best shot.
Yeah.
So I don't think we'll know if VR has truly failed until basically after this console generation.
Yeah.
And even like then, they might try and refresh it with, you know, the next generation of consoles. They actually almost definitely will, because there's no reason they're investing this much now just to abandon it later.
Yeah, no, it's not like the Vita.
Yeah, I don't think this is going to be a win-or-lose, you know, boom-or-bust thing. I think this is going to go on for a while.
Yeah, the thing is that PlayStation VR is the cheapest way to get into VR gaming right now. And apparently it's good, like, if not great. So... Yeah. It's the thing for me is I had to cancel my pre-order because I wasn't willing to invest $500, but
I think that's a smart move.
It's you can go later on if there's like a sale for like $100 off, $400, ideally like $200 off for $300, you know, I'd be like, that's not bad.
Yeah, or maybe when version 2.0 comes out, you know, I just bought a PS4 Slim that, by the way, is definitely quieter.
Mm.
And is definitely like it does run. We had this conversation where I was like, but no. It's definitely. It does. Yeah, and it could be the fact that it's not full of dust yet.
Yeah, that's
like
a good
we
point.
Don't know where it's going to be 3 years down the line where my PS4 was when it died.
So, like, it's
like
a smoker.
You get what I'm saying, right?
Yeah, you know, like it's the dust is the cigarettes to your PlayStation, and
it's the lung cancer to my
PlayStation. Yeah,
jeez, it's so sad.
Kind of is.
Anyway, we'll move on. Lawrence PTW. I don't know what this stands for.
He asked the same question as...
very similar question to Men on Solid.
Yes, correct.
In asking for your Gears of War impressions.
Yes.
I think we're good on
that. Yeah, you kind of heard it before.
Thank you very much for your question.
Yes, thank you.
Joey Maloney. Joey Maloney.
Baloney now.
I bet that was like a school, like a playground thing. Anyway, are you watching Westworld? Would you go? What kind of theme would you like to see besides Western? We actually meant to talk about Westworld at some point, or we at least discussed
mentioned
it.
That we haven't watched it yet.
Yeah, we both really want to watch it. Yeah, we know. We did talk about it.
Yeah, we talked about how
we
it's
both
blowing
need to
up.
Watch it. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, no, unfortunately, neither one of us has watched it yet. I think we should definitely watch it. If not together, then we at least at some point, we both need to get on that train.
Yeah, I still have to finish Ballers with Dave. I just remembered that.
Anyway,
I'm behind.
Other themes for me, I mean, I'm always into sci-fi.
Love sci-fi.
I would like to see them, you know, if they want to stay kind of in the past, they could try like a fantasy thing, you know, and like bringing the worlds of... I'm saying, like, in terms of worlds that you could, like, see people... see brought to life. But I don't think they go down that road because, frankly, like, it's Game of Thrones. They would just be like... it'd be like a season of Game of Thrones again.
Yeah. By the way, did you see the thing I shared on Facebook?
No.
There's concerts.
I literally never go on Facebook.
There is a concert that they're going to be doing at, like, MSG and some of the other big arenas. Where it's going to be like an orchestra, like a chorus, but like the stage setup is awesome where it has like the orchestra is inside there. But from what they're showing is that there's like screens that go on top of them. So they're kind of hidden and they have video shown on them.
Oh, cool.
Like over them. And there's a giant screen and it's under $100 to get like real close seats.
Are you kind of debating? Are you pitching me on this?
I'm kind of debating like, about going.
It sounds like you're trying to give it a go.
The Philadelphia one is the one on a Saturday.
Oh, okay.
So, I mean, I'm thinking about it.
I'll probably be working.
Bummer. So, the next question comes from...
Amy Gills.
Oh, Amy Gills. As we spoke about previously, unfortunately, Ismael did not get it up. Well, it's not their fault. We recorded before that they released the video.
But she's asking about the Voltron...
the Power Rangers versus Voltron video. She was asking for, like, what we thought about it.
Maybe next week.
I'll definitely have an answer next week. I am very excited because I'm pretty sure it's up now, and I really want to watch it.
Dang.
Yeah.
So let's finish the last question, and we can get out of here.
Yes. The next question comes from our boy, Andrew Francis. He asked, the launch is here. What are your final hopes and expectations for PlayStation VR, and which launch titles excite you the most?
I don't really have any launch titles that I find particularly exciting. I'm not really interested in horror, which is like a big component of a couple of these games. I don't know. Do you have an answer?
For the thing is that, like I said, I wasn't going to invest the $500 into PlayStation VR as it was. The experiences that I'd be interested in, are, like, I've heard nothing but great things about the Batman VR.
That's true. That is the one that I think I would be. But yeah.
I'm not super into horror as well, but I watch horror movies.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if I'm down to terrify myself with Resident Evil 7.
Yeah, especially on VR. Like in VR. Like I mean, call me I'm definitely paranoid, but like I don't even know. Like I don't know how comfortable I would feel like sitting in a room with that. Like you know, taking away most of my senses because I don't trust the people around me. You know. So, like, I would be concerned almost to, like, I think I would be too freaked out by a horror game in VR.
Yeah, I mean, there are apparently some really good games that are available, that are getting great reviews. I don't know if you saw IGN's, little post about all the PlayStation VR launch titles and their reviews.
No.
There's some that are getting, like, nines and eights and...
Yeah, I mean, I listened to the most recent podcast Beyond and I heard a bunch of people talk about different games that were...
Yeah, yeah.
And, like, some of them I'm interested in, some of them I don't really care. I think Super Hypercube or whatever, I think that's what the game's called.
I think, yeah, that one got the best review.
I think that is the one of the more interesting ones, but to me it sounds like a game that wouldn't be able to sustain my attention for longer than a couple gameplay sessions.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't want to, like, you know, crap on it just for that, but if that is the most exciting launch game for me and I'm not even that interested in it, it's not the right time for me to buy.
No, it's just wait until you see something that you are interested in. It's kind of what it comes down to. But I am excited for PlayStation VR. I really do want it to be successful.
Yes.
Like I think that this is the next level of gaming that we can get into. But there's obviously going to be a little bit of a rough entry point. And it's like this one is one of the largest steps that we've ever taken in gaming.
I think so.
And it's a little daunting, but I do hope that this does launch. I really do.
Yeah, I hope it really does take off.
Yeah. But I think that's about it for the episode.
Oh, absolutely.
I see that the video did launch.
So.
And I really want to watch it. So we're going to close this out and then I'm going to go watch it on the big screen.
Super hungry anyway.
Oh, I haven't eaten. Oh, no, I'm sorry. I ate all of Kelsey's mini wheats.
Does she know that yet?
Yep.
Oh, okay, I was going to say, is she going to find out from this?
Well, no, she would learn when she gets home. Yeah.
Okay.
But yeah, so anyway, thank you guys so much. I really apologize for the delay on us being off for as well as the video. I'm going to try to get that up and running as soon as possible. And
the audio of this episode.
Well, hopefully this microphone works a little bit better, but I think what we're going to have to do from now on is...
Just record with that one.
Yeah.
I mean, the audio
I'm
going
to have to send that out for repair.
It's fine. I mean, the audio sounds good anyway with this.
Yeah, it's not ideal, but because I was looking at another one of those. I mean, I can buy that one again for like $200, but if I wanted. It's already failed us. I was looking at one that I know works, because I saw it work at Comic-Con, but it is $300, $400.
It might be something to look into in the future. Anyway, it's something we're going to try and get sorted out. And in the meantime, thank you for your patience. I hope that you're all enjoying us being back. I know I definitely felt a lot of pent-up opinions inside my brain that I wanted to get out to you people. So
it's it's been an interesting couple of weeks. And, you know, I didn't pay too much attention to a lot of gaming news. But just kind of being back in the seat feels good.
Yeah, it really does. Good. And, yeah, I mean, we'll keep pushing as long as you guys are there to listen. So,
yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yes. Thank you again. And, if you wanted to follow us on Twitter, I am Fred_Sully. This is Jack is Gaming on Twitter. If you wanted to follow and get the news and updates from Nerds Online, be sure to follow at Nerds Podcast as I slap my pop filter. Be sure to subscribe to us on YouTube. We are going to have maybe a few more different videos other than the podcast going up there soon. So if you are interested in those, please be sure to subscribe.
That was a gross noise.
It's
whatever.
Got to work out the rust. You got to kick the old bucket.
Kick.
That's dying, isn't it?
Yeah. Kick the tires, test the air pressure, I guess.
What I meant.
Are we talking about cars? I don't really know.
Fucking know anymore. Okay. Also, if you have any written work that you would like to have submitted, or video work for that matter.
Take whatever.
Yeah, but really. Be sure to go to nerdsonline.com/community-entry.
Yep.
The little thing will be down there. We'd be happy to share any of your stuff. If you just want to spread the word a little bit more, then let us know. We'll be down to hang out and do it. I don't know what I'm saying anymore.
It's been
rough.
We gotta rev up the engines. We should get away from car metaphors. I don't know anything about cars.
I know a little bit, but not enough.
Okay.
All right.
That's the end of the show.
Yeah. Anyway, guys, thank you very much, and keep nerding out. Thank you for watching the video. Make sure to like, subscribe, and share the video if you can. Also, make sure to follow us on Twitter. Keep nerding out.